Right, so we are looking at the crystal vibrations or lattice vibrations. And let me just recapitulate a little bit. So what we had done was we had taken an all electron plus all atom model of a crystal. Okay. And then we applied the Born-Oppenheimer approximation to this. And by applying the Born-Oppenheimer approximation, we obtained a decoupling of the electron and ion degrees of freedom. And then from here, we did a Taylor's expansion of the electronic potential or the potential energy surface. This gave us small oscillations about the equilibrium position. And from here, we derived the model of a crystal as a system of coupled harmonic oscillators. So when we derive this coupled harmonic oscillator system, then you can ask the question, does the electrons have any input in this? Because the spring constant that is here, the second derivative or the curvature, second derivative of the potential energy surface. And the potential energy surface itself was derived by solving the electron problem. Okay. So you can see how this entire scheme progresses. And if you want to do a more and more sophisticated theory, then you can go backwards in this direction, right? Or even sitting here, for example, even sitting at the crystal as a system of coupled harmonic oscillators, you can make this more sophisticated and add anharmonic oscillations. And if you so that is again equivalent to doing a Taylor's expansion to higher order. And then if you want to do something more sophisticated, then go ahead and look at the situations where this electron and ion degrees of freedom are both dynamic, so include electron phonon coupling. So if you want to go beyond this, then you include electron phonon coupling. And if you want to go even beyond that, then there are two directions. One is you can look at the situations where the Born-Oppenheimer approximation is violated, or in this situation where the electrons and phonons are coupled, here you can include, for example, phonons which are anharmonic or electrons which are strongly interacting, right? So, and all kinds of situations. For example, you can also include here spin. So there is a spin phonon coupling, for example. So there are various levels at which you can complicate the situation. And indeed, for every complication that you can think of, nature provides some systems where that particular situation can arise, okay? So that's the beauty of this, and I would encourage you to think about various directions starting from here, and then also come up with real material systems where such threads can be explored. Okay. So with this, we had also looked at a 1D harmonic crystal. So let me just revise that. So basically, what we said is that let's consider a system of 1D coupled harmonic oscillators. Okay, and we had applied periodic boundary conditions to this. So we had a ring. All right, and with this ring, we had derived a potential energy, which was half K times U N. Sorry. UN minus UN plus 1 whole squared. So from here we had used Newton's equations and derived the equation of motion. And by deriving the equation of motion, we had been able to go to K space. So there were two. One second, somebody wants to be admitted. Okay, so from here we said that there are two possible directions. One is you can directly solve these in real space. And if you solve these in real space, you will have to solve a large matrix. Okay, you have to diagonalize that. Or you can go to K space. And in K space, you have to solve, you directly get the dispersion. Okay, so this is the most elegant solution, that is the K-space solution. But the K-space solution only works if you had periodic boundary conditions. For open boundary conditions, this is the only way, right? So open boundary conditions, which means that you don't have a ring, but you have, let's say, clamped the wire at the two ends, okay? And by clamping the wire, you want to find out what are the different normal modes. So in that case, then you have to use the real space solution. Okay, so by doing all this, what had we found? We had found that the dispersion, which means omega as a function of k, was omega k squared is 4k by m sine squared k a by 2. Okay, so this was the dispersion that we had found. So what this meant was that, and remember, k took n values from minus pi by a to pi by a, right? So if k takes n values, there are n possible normal modes of this particular 1D wire. And for each normal mode, there is a particular frequency and there's a particular wavelength. And that's why we call them phonons. All right. So the reason these are called acoustic modes is because when k tends to zero, then we find that omega is proportional to k. Okay, so that's why this is called the acoustic branch or acoustic modes. So related to the sound basically, and the velocity of the sound is given by this proportionality constant here. So before we go on to the next problem, in fact, we had also plotted the dispersion relation as a function of k, and what we had seen was something like this. So it's linear here and it saturates near the Brillouin zone edges. Okay, so in the chat box, I had asked a question. So do you think this 1D crystal is just an idealization, or are there real low dimensional systems? So let me begin by saying, so this is not a rhetorical question. I mean, I'm really asking the question, but before you start answering, we know that 2D crystals exist. And we had several examples of these. In fact, the spectacular work of Novoselov and Geim on graphene. So it led to a whole revolution in terms of 2D materials. So 2D materials, we know. I mean, 2D materials exist. They have been well studied. And there are a lot of potential technological applications of 2D materials. So, but the question I'm asking is, the 1D crystal that we have just studied, is that just a toy model? Or are there real systems which can be thought of as 1D crystals?
So,
yeah.
There's something like nanowire.
It's 1D. Okay. Excellent. So, nanowires can be made out of several materials, and some of the most famous ones include gold nanowires. Okay. So, yes, gold nanowires behave like quasi 1D systems. So, naturally, there is always a width to the systems, so they behave as quasi 1D crystals. Oh, all right. So, anything else? Do you think there are any other 1D crystalline systems? Anything? Take a wild guess. What about nanotubes? So nanotubes also behave as quasi-1D systems, but then here there is a small distinction. So nanotubes definitely have a certain width. So suppose we consider single-walled nanotubes. Okay? So nanotubes have a certain width to them, and they are of the order of nanometers.
Yes, sir. They have some diameter.
That's correct, yeah. So they have a certain diameter. So why am I calling them 1D crystals? So it turns out that if you look at the electronic properties, okay, then the electronic properties of these systems can be described as 1D. But if you look at the, let's say the vibrational properties, then it's not exactly 1D. It's somewhere between 1D and 2D. Okay. Why do I say somewhere between 1D and 2D? It's because if I open up this nanotube, then I would get a rectangle. Okay. And if I take this rectangle and then, you know, join it back, I will get the tube. And then if I join the two other ends, I will get a torus. Okay. So that would become a torus. But it turns out that for every single configuration that I can create, so this rectangle is an open boundary condition 2D crystal. And if I apply periodic boundary conditions to one of the ends, I will get a tube. And if I apply periodic boundary conditions to the other end also, I will get a torus. So it turns out that the vibrational properties of each of these configurations will be different. Okay. So the tube is somewhere between a 1D and a 2D because you have applied periodic boundary conditions in one end, but not at the other one. All right. So so you can see that there is something interesting that has happened here, that even though the system appears to be, according to the atomic arrangement, it's not a one-dimensional system, the electronic properties do behave like a 1D system. Okay. So are there other examples? Can you think of other examples which behave like 1D?
Yeah? Sir, can we also consider nanorods?
Nanorods, yes. So nanorods, the only problem with nanorods is that the length of these nanorods is extremely tiny. Okay. So they could be of the order of, you know, tens of nanometers. Right. Whereas if you consider nanowires, then the nanowires can be made even, you know, up to tens of microns. So similarly, nanotubes also can be made up to tens of microns, which means that there is a 3 order of magnitude difference in the aspect ratio of these two systems. Right. So the nanorods, basically the length versus width is not extremely different. So the aspect ratio is not extremely high. Whereas if you look at the nanotubes and nanowires, the aspect ratio is really, really large. Their diameter is of the order of nanometers, while their length could be of the order of microns. So the aspect ratio reaches 1,000. So yes, more examples. No? So what about polymers? Do you think polymers behave as 1D systems? There is a very famous polymer which is connected to a Nobel Prize. Or there are many polymers which are connected to Nobel Prize, but one of the very first ones. Have you heard of Sue Schrieffer-Hegar? Polymers are, there are polymeric crystals also. There are small polymers which form crystals. Okay, for example, pentacene does form crystal, and there are many other such small polymers which form crystals. Okay, but we are talking about large Dalton weight polymers. So what I am talking about are these 1D chains. Okay, polymeric chains, and these 1D polymeric chains which have monomer units, they actually behave like 1D systems. Okay. And one very famous example is polyacetylene. So which is basically C here. that's what it is. Let me just flash this. No, this is not what I'm looking for. So, right. So there is something called a cis and a trans also, but let me not go into the details of the chemistry. But basically what you see is shown here. So can you see the screen? Can you see the image of polyacetylene?
Sir.
Oh, yes, sir. Good.
Yeah. So this is actually a very interesting system. The polyacetylene system is a very interesting system. Very close to being 1D. Okay, it's idea. I mean, you can study it as a 1D system. There are, in fact, many, many polymeric systems which behave as quasi 1D systems.
Okay, sir, I can't see them.
But were you able to see the sketch board on which I was writing?
I'm seeing the terminal of the module.
Oh, you're seeing the terminal?
Yeah.
How about now? Maybe there is some network back?
Yeah, it is visible now.
Ah, it's visible. Yeah, maybe there is some network.
Okay, sir.
What I'm saying is, if you look at polyacetylene or many such polymeric systems, they turn out to be quasi-1D in the sense that you can model them as 1D systems. And if you take a polymeric matrix, so if you take a whole film of polymers in which the 1D polymeric chains have been compressed into some sort of a matrix, then you will find that there are cross links that have developed. Okay, but these crosslinks are usually much weaker than the intra-chain bonding, right? So these things do behave as quasi-1D systems, but they also retain their molecular nature. Look at the molecular levels. Let's say if you look at the atomic levels of sodium and you look at the band structure of sodium, there is no correspondence. Okay, so the atomic nature of sodium does not manifest itself in the band structure of sodium. But in the case of polymers, that's very different. The monomeric molecular energy levels do manifest themselves very strongly in the crystalline, not band structure, I would say, but energy level structure. Okay. So the homo-lumo levels are actually preserved, even though this whole thing is in a crystalline form or is in a lattice form. So, but then why am I mentioning this? Okay, so it turns out that polyacetylene and many other quasi-1D systems have a very interesting phenomenon. Okay, so in the last slide, I mentioned about the Born-Oppenheimer approximation and we have discussed quite a bit about it. So it turns out there is a violation of the Born-Oppenheimer approximation in these quasi-1D systems. Okay, so the first 1D system that we studied, right, which is that of a pristine periodic lattice with just one atom basis. This is what we had looked at. Turns out, if you add electrons to this, okay, then this is an unstable system. And the instability is called the Pyle's instability or the Pyle's distortion. Okay, so that's very interesting because what is happening is that the electron phonon coupling leads to an instability of the lattice itself, right? And you can read about it in many places. There are very interesting accounts of this, but basically what happens is that the lattice, once it starts exploring the normal modes, it turns out that for certain normal modes, the electronic system may develop a kind of a band gap. Okay, so let me show you another picture. I have that that's there in the Wikipedia. So, yeah. So can all of you see this?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes.
So you see what is happening here, that there is a clean 1D lattice, but then something has happened here. Okay, so there is something called a dimerization that has happened. So every two neighboring atoms, they have come closer or gone further, closer or further, right? So this had a single period. Okay, it was a monatomic basis lattice, whereas here what we have got is that the lattice parameter has actually doubled. Okay, so the lattice parameter has doubled, but and the basis has become diatomic. Okay, in fact, this is the problem that we are going to consider next. So the phonon modes of this problem we have considered, and now we will be considering this problem. Okay, this is the problem with a diatomic basis. But then I wanted to show you that this kind of a transition actually happens in nature, and this transition, the dimerization transition, is known as the Pyle's instability. But the way this happens is again very interesting. The adiabaticity that we have assumed in deriving the Born-Oppenheimer approximation actually breaks down. Okay, the electron system and the phonon system, they couple together strongly, and the lattice vibrations give rise to not only a structural transition but also an electronic transition. Okay, so both things happen here simultaneously. So essentially what happens is as follows. Let me show you the picture again. So here you see a 1D lattice, and for this 1D lattice the electronic band structure is given here, okay, in this picture. And what you can see is that the Fermi level is somewhere here, so which means that the band is partially filled. Okay, and if the band is partially filled, the system should be a metal. So this system, which is undistorted or a proper 1D monatomic lattice, should be a metal. But what has been actually found is that a dimerization happens, and accompanying the dimerization, a band gap opens at the Fermi level. Okay, so what is happening here is that because of certain phonon modes which are being explored, it turns out that the electronic subsystem would lower its energy by opening a band gap. Okay, so there is a coupling of the phonons and electrons, and eventually the electronic subsystem lowers its energy and offsets the elastic energy cost. Okay, so the total energy of the system actually decreases by doing this dimerization and by opening up a gap. So both transitions, electronic transition in terms of a metal insulator transition, and the structural transition in terms of a monatomic to a diatomic lattice or a dimerization, happen simultaneously. So this is known as the Pyle's instability, because a proper monatomic 1D crystal becomes unstable when you add electrons to this system and include the electron phonon interactions. Okay, so there are many other things also that happen which are related to this, and I would encourage you to read about them. So there is something called a cone anomaly, and a cone anomaly in the extreme case becomes an instability. Okay, but usually a cone anomaly is just an anomaly in the sense that the phonon dispersion will possibly take a dip. So the phonon dispersion that we saw was basically this. This was the acoustic branch, and the acoustic branch had a linear part, and this was saturating. But imagine that at some point it goes through such a dip, okay, where it's the dispersion is continuous but it is non-differentiable, right? So this would be known as a Kohn's anomaly or a Kohn anomaly. Okay, so but in extreme cases, when this the mode actually touches zero, that is when there will be an instability. Okay, and the Pyle's instability is one example of such an anomaly. So these models are actually not toy models. There are real material systems which do correspond to 1D crystals, 1D crystals with a diatomic basis, and you know, multiple atom basis also, right? The other thing is that if you, I already told you about one system where the system behaves as 1D electronically, but not as 1D or a finite D, greater than one, if you consider vibrational properties. Okay, so there are other systems which do similar things. For example, there are magnetic systems okay, where the magnetism is 1D, but the phonons are 3D. Okay, so you might ask, how does this happen? So it turns out that if you take a bulk 1D crystal, if you take this bulk 3D crystal, then the spins are arranged in a quasi 1D fashion. So there could be, you know, things like this, where the spins are arranged in a certain way, right? And the magnetism happens only along these directions, whereas there is hardly any coupling between the spin chains. So these are known as spin chain compounds. So you can look them up, where the magnetism becomes 1D, but the entire lattice, because it's strongly bonded, the phonons become three-dimensional. Okay, so this is again an emergent phenomenon where the same system behaves as a 1D system when it corresponds to a certain property, but it corresponds to a 3D system when it comes to a different property. Okay, so there are not only spin chain compounds, there are something called spin ladder compounds. Okay? And then there is a square lattice. So there could be a manifestly 3D system which behaves like a quasi 2D system. Okay. So, and prime examples of these where such things happen are high TC cuprates. So in high TC cuprates, these are full 3D systems. Okay. So the phonons will also be 3D. But then it turns out the electronic properties are actually 2D electronic properties. And the superconductivity also arises in the 2D layers. So there are these 2D layers which are separated by, these are copper oxide layers, and these are separated by the rare earth materials, and because of that the distance between the layers is very large and the conduction only happens in these layers. Okay, so these are the high TC cuprates are manifestly 3D systems. So if you look at the vibrational properties, phonons and so on, you will find 3D phonons, but they will be anisotropic for sure. But if you look at the electronic properties, then they are almost quasi 2D. Okay, so one has to keep in mind these kind of things, that if you are looking at a bulk system, then not necessarily everything will behave like bulk. Okay, there could be things, there could be properties of that system which could behave in a low dimensional way. Okay, so with this, let's move on to the actual toy model. I mean, the another model that we would like to study, and that will bring about another aspect of phonons, which is the optical branch. Okay, so the next model that I want to consider is this model, which is a dimerized model. So in a dimerized model, what you are seeing is that the unit cell has two atoms. Okay, so no, it should go all the way up to here and then here and so on. Okay, so this is one unit cell, and one unit cell has two atoms. So the essential idea here is that let's call this A, let's call this B, let's call this A, let's call this B, and so on. So the way there is a spring constant is different for intra-unit cell and inter-unit cell. For intra-unit cell bonds and for inter-unit cell bonds. So if we have this kind of a model, then we will replace this by a spring model. Okay, so let's call this as K, and then let's call this as G. Okay, and say that okay, so I have said D and A. The entire lattice parameter, let's call this A. And then again, this will be repeated. So this is K and then G. So is the model clear? If there is any doubt, let me know. Okay. So there are two spring constants in this. And what we will do is, again, we will solve the classical problem. Okay. And what I'll do is, at the end of this class, just remind me, I will also show you the quantum mechanical solution of the 1D spring, of the 1D monoatomic crystal, right? We have done only the classical solution. I will show you that the quantum mechanical solution of the full 1D crystal also gives you exactly the same normal modes as the classical solution. There is no difference at all. It's only that the way the Hamiltonian diagonalizes is different for the quantum mechanical case versus the classical case, where it's not, where the eigen, where the energy values are not discrete, they are continuous. So for this, what we will do is we will start again with the potential energy of the whole system. So in the harmonic approximation, and that is given by k by 2 sum over n u1 of na, let's say, minus u2 of na whole squared plus g by 2 u2 of na minus u1 of n plus 1 a whole squared. Okay, so what have we done here? First of all, you see that there is a k and there is a g. So this is the intra unit cell. When you class 334 call one. Thanks. Yeah, so this is the intra unit cell spring constant and this is the inter unit cell. Now how do I know this inter unit cell? You see that the n index is exactly the same. So the n is actually a unit cell index. So the displacements of the atom A minus displacement of the atom B inside one unit cell that is connected through the spring K, and the displacement of atom B and the displacement of atom A, okay, in neighboring unit cells is connected through the spring G. Okay. So given this, now we can do again exactly the same thing that we had done for the monatomic lattice, which means we will derive the forces on the A and B atoms, and then we will basically solve those equations. So if there are n unit cells in this chain, okay, question is how many equations will we get? So that's a question. How many equations will we get that we have to solve? Any answers?
2n equations.
2n equations. Why do you, yeah, why do you say that?
We are having two atoms per unit cell.
Okay. So, and because we have two atoms per unit cell, every atom would be writing one equation, which means there will be 2n equations. Now, if we go to K space, okay, if we go again to the reciprocal space, how many K values will we get? So again, another question. How many K values will we get? So there are n unit cells in the chain, and as you answered, for a diatomic lattice, it's a two atom basis. Hence, there will be 2n equations. Very good. Now, how many k values will we get?
N k values.
N k values. Why is that? Why not 2n?
Because I have to put the boundary condition on the unit cells.
Exactly. Not on the atoms. Very good. So, the number of k values that we will be getting is n, because this arises from the periodic boundary condition and we only have n unit cells. So, the number of the, what is periodic is the unit cell and not the atom itself, right? So which means that we have to take, we will be getting n values of the momentum. Very good. So from this conclusion that we have 2n equations, what would be the size of the matrix that we would have to solve to get the normal modes in real space? What would be the size of the matrix that we would have to solve? If you remember, in the 1D case also, we solved a real space matrix, and here were the displacements, and here were the m omega squared minus the k by m, and so on and so forth. So this is where the constants were present, and this is where the variables were present. So what will be the dimension of this matrix, order of this matrix?
2n by 2n.
Very good. So 2n by 2n, and this would be, for example, u1 of the first unit cell, u2 of the first unit cell, then u1 of the second unit cell, u2 of the second unit cell, and so on. Right? So there will be 2n by 2n matrix, and what this means is how many normal modes?
Two n normal modes.
Exactly. So we will get 2n normal modes. Now, if we have only n k values, whereas we have 2n normal modes, that would mean that for every 1 k value, we have 2 modes. Okay. So remember, in the monatomic lattice, there were n k values. There were n k values and n normal modes. Okay, which is why when we drew the omega k versus k, there was something like this. So for every k, there was one normal mode. For every k, there was one normal mode, right? But now here we are finding that there are n k values, but there will be 2n normal modes. So which means that for every k, there is one more omega k sitting somewhere. For this k also, there is one more omega k sitting somewhere, right? And that gives us a hint that there is going to be a second branch in this system. Okay, now whether that branch actually goes towards zero, whether it goes towards a constant, that is something that we will see, right? But already from here we can see that there are going to be two branches of the phonon modes. One branch will be the acoustic branch, because that acoustic branch comes from the Goldstone's theorem, that is, you are breaking the translational symmetry, so the acoustic branch always has to be present. Whether the second branch will be an optical branch or not, we will see that, right? By solving the equations in k space, we will find out, right? Is this discussion clear to everyone? Are there doubts? No? Very good. Okay, so we can again write down Newton's equations, okay? And the basic assumption or the basic ansatz that we will be using is the following. U1 is some epsilon 1 times e to the power I kna minus omega t, and u2 is epsilon 2 e to the power I kna minus omega t. So again, notice that the u1 and u2 correspond to the two atoms in the unit cell. So this is atom A, this is atom B, this is u1, okay, and this is u2. Similarly, again, there will be u1 here and u2 here. Now what is interesting is that we have taken an ansatz where the amplitude of u1 and u2 are different, right? So the A atom and the B atom oscillate with different amplitudes, but the wavelength is exactly the same and the frequency is also exactly the same, right? So the entire crystal is vibrating at a single frequency and a single momentum, single k, okay? Now, but the amplitudes of each of these atoms could be different, right? So using this ansatz, if you substitute it in those equations, in the equations derived through the potential energy, you will get the following two equations. You will get m omega squared minus k plus g times epsilon 1 plus k plus g e to the power minus I k a epsilon 2 equal to 0. And the second equation that you will get is this. So this is m1, sorry, and there is an m2 omega squared minus k plus g epsilon 2 k plus g e to the power I k a epsilon 1 equal to 0. So given this, this equations have the structure of a 2 by 2 matrix with epsilon 1, epsilon 2 equal to 0. Okay, and if epsilon 1, epsilon 2 have to be non-zero because we want the u1 and u2 to be non-zero, then this matrix has to be singular. Okay, and with the condition that this matrix has to be singular, which means the determinant has to be 0, you can see that we will get a relation between omega and k. Right, so the determinant being equal to 0 gives us the condition that gives us the omega k values. Omega k is obtained by putting the determinant equal to 0. Okay, so what you get is the following. So omega k, and this is a special case that we are doing. So we are doing here m1 equal to m2. So this is again not an idealization. Polyacetylene is a system of exactly this kind. M1 is equal to M2, right? Because all of them are carbons. So omega k squared is basically given by k plus g by m plus or minus 1 by m square root k plus g whole squared minus n squared k a by 2 times k g. Okay, so indeed we see that there are two branches for each k. Okay, and these two branches are arising because we had a 2 by 2 matrix, and this 2 by 2 matrix, when we solved, we got two solutions for each omega k. Okay, so for each k there are two possible omega values given by the plus and the minus, right? So one will lie lower and one will lie higher. That's the point. So now you can see that if this was a triatomic basis, correct? So suppose I had three atoms in the basis and then again separated by this. So separated by the lattice parameter and then again three atoms, then I would get a 3 by 3 matrix. And for a 3 by 3 matrix, I would get three solutions for omega k squared, which means there would be three branches. So in a 1D crystal, if I had three atom bases, I would get three different branches. Okay, and the same argument can be generalized to multiple situations. If you now incorporate multiple degrees of freedom, then you will have many more branches, right? And you can count the number of equations that you will be getting by looking at the degrees of freedom and by looking at the number of atoms in the basis, and then arrive at how many branches you will have. Okay, and then there are other powerful arguments to argue when you can get acoustic branches, when you can get transverse, when you can get longitudinal, when you will get optical, things like that. Okay, but let me not go into the details of the phonons because that is not that is actually out of scope of this course. But I want to focus on the two branches that arise within this simple model of a diatomic crystal. So given this, what we can do is we can also find out the ratio of the two amplitudes, and that is given by epsilon 1 by epsilon 2. That turns out to be equal to m omega squared minus k plus g divided by k plus g e to the power minus I k a. Okay, so and that in fact this is actually equal to plus or minus mod of k plus g e to the power minus I k a divided by k plus g e to the power minus I k a. This is actually plus, sorry. Yeah, so this is the ratio of the amplitudes and these are the normal modes. Okay, so what we will do is we will look at the expression of these normal modes in a certain limit, right? So we will look at the limit k tends to 0. So in the limit k tends to 0, you can do an expansion of the omega k squared that we had written, And what you will find is as follows. You will get epsilon 2 is actually equal to minus or plus epsilon 1. Okay? So which means there are two possible ways in which the two atoms are moving. In one case, the epsilon 2 is equal to epsilon 1, right? Which means the two atoms are moving exactly in the same direction. In the other case, epsilon 2 is minus epsilon 1, which means this atom is moving this way, but this atom is moving exactly opposite, right? So you can see that in one case, there is a kind of a propagating mode. And in the other case, you see that there is a kind of a non-propagating mode. Okay, so this is what will lead to the optical mode or the optical branch. Okay, and this will lead to the acoustic branch. Let's see how that arises, right? So when k tends to 0, if I take the, I'm sorry, I said the wrong thing. Huh? Okay, so one of the cases you will get omega plus is square root of twice k plus g by m. Okay, and then you will get order k squared corrections, right? That's correct. So the omega minus is this. This is the optical branch. Okay. And the omega plus is given by kg by 2m k plus g times ka. Okay. And this is the acoustic branch. So let me explain. So what you see here is that if I take the omega minus, which means the minus solution, right, then I get a constant. This is a constant. See that there is no momentum here, plus order k squared corrections. Okay. And the k squared corrections will decrease the magnitude of this. And if I take the plus solution in which in phase, both the A and B atoms are moving in phase, then what I get is a constant multiplied by ka. So this is of the form omega proportional to k, hence this is a acoustic branch. Okay, and if I plot the full dispersion, then what I see is something like this. This goes like this, and this one comes up and goes up like this. Okay, so this is the minus branch and this is the plus branch. Right, so this is called the optical branch, and you can see that near k tends to 0, this is getting flat, right? And because it is flat, you can see that this is not going to be a propagating mode. The velocity of this mode is going to be 0, right? But this one has a finite velocity, so this is propagating. Okay, so there are two kinds of branches. Okay, in the long wavelength limit, the optical branch and the acoustic branch. The optical branch, we call it dispersionless, right? Because you can see that the optical branch very weakly depends on the k, whereas the acoustic branch strongly depends on the k in the long wavelength limit, and in the short wavelength limit, both of them become dispersionless, right? Only in a very small region, the optical branch has a slight dispersion. That's it. So usually you will find that all optical branches will be mostly dispersionless, or will have a very weak dispersion, okay? Which means their dependence, the omega k dependence on k, will be extremely weak. Also, you can see that the omega k for the optical branch, even at k equal to 0, is finite, correct? Which means that you need a finite amount of energy to excite any optical mode, okay? Even in the long wavelength limit. Right, but whereas in the long wavelength limit, the acoustic branch can be excited even with extremely tiny amounts of energy. Okay, in fact, there are zero energy modes also here, right? So that's a very important thing to remember. The reason is that when you supply any heat energy, for example, to a crystal, then that heat energy gets dissipated in some form, right? You have to ask the question, what are the degrees of freedom inside a crystal which will absorb that energy that you're supplying, unless that energy is equal to the mode, you will not be able to excite the optical modes, right? But the acoustic modes will immediately get excited. We talk about, for example, electron phonon scattering, or even when we talk about the Pyle's instability and things like that, it's the acoustic modes that are actually participating. So this is what we get by looking at the diatomic lattice. You can also look at what happens in the short wavelength limit near the Brillouin zone edge. It turns out that omega plus goes to square root of 2k by m with epsilon 2 equal to minus epsilon 1. This is the minus solution. It gives you 2g by m. Okay, the omega minus. So this is what happens. So the two branches basically relate to these two values. Okay, so this is root 2k by m, and this is root 2g by m. Okay, at the Brillouin zone edge, that you can see that there is a gap between these two branches. Okay, and in that sense, you can think of them as the electronic system also, that these are two bands. And there is a similarity, because in the electronic bands also, the EK depends on K, right? But it also has an index called N. There are multiple bands. For example, when we draw these conduction and valence bands in our 12 standard, right? Then the X axis is K and the Y axis is EK. So these are the two bands of the electronic system, right? And these are the two energy levels, which means for the same K, you have multiple energy values. It's exactly the same thing here, that for the same K, you have multiple omega K values. Okay, so the branches of the phonon system are have a one-to-one correspondence with the bands of the electronic system. And now there is a deeper meaning to this. Okay, the deeper meaning is that if you look at the electronic system, the reason you get bands is because electrons behave as waves. Electrons have an extended wave function, and they are spread throughout the crystal lattice, and that happens because of the Bloch's theorem, right? And that happens because of the quantum mechanical nature of the electron, right? Because of that, you get these bands, right? Electronic bands. Now here, phonons are already waves. Okay, so we actually approximate them as particles, right? But originally speaking, itself they are waves. Even classically, they are waves. Why classically we can get all these pictures of the branches and so on, okay, even though these phonons are classical. So just because of their wave nature, right? So that's a very significant thing, that even classically you can observe several phenomena of the wave nature in the phonon system, quantum mechanical nature of the electron. Okay, so is this discussion clear to everyone? Yeah. See, I understand that this is a graveyard shift. And, have had lunch, and then most of you would be extremely sleepy. So, and those who are sleeping will obviously not even realize what I'm saying. So, those of you who are sleeping, please wake them up and tell them that I'm telling that you guys are sleeping. Yeah, but you guys have chosen this time, so I'm sorry. Are there any doubts? Any questions?
No.
Okay. Good. Fine. So, let me move on now to the quantum mechanical solution of the 1D crystal itself. So, we had taken the 1D ring, and then we wrote down the potential energy from which we derived the force equations, and from this we got the normal modes.
Sir.
Yes.
Sir, I have a question.
Yes.
In the previous, sir, Ritam.
Ritam, yeah.
Sir, in the previous slide, you showed that optical and acoustical branches are separated by a forbidden frequency band. Okay.
Yeah.
So what happens in that frequency? Why can't we excite the crystal in that very frequency mode? Any frequency between that band.
So essentially, it turns out that first of all, when you look at the problem in real space, you will be getting a real symmetric matrix. The real symmetric matrix will have only real eigenvalues. Right? Now, it turns out, and in fact, you will be doing a problem of this kind also in the assignments. Okay, when you do phonons, you will see that there are actually modes even possible which are in the gap, but they turn out to be imaginary. And that is why you cannot excite them. They are unstable. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
So you will see an example of such a thing when you assign the chapters at the back of the Kittel's chapter. You will see that there are such problems where you will see modes getting excited within the band gap. Okay, so essentially the idea has to do again with interference. Okay, so why are certain normal modes allowed and why are certain normal modes not allowed? Right, so if you think about the omega k, then you can see that k can take only certain values. Omega k corresponding to those k can also take only certain values. So these are again to do with the wave phenomena and since we have taken periodic boundary conditions, these are all kind of standing waves. Okay, not exactly standing waves, but they have to satisfy certain interference conditions. Okay, and that is where all this arises from.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
So for every k, we are having two different frequencies.
That's correct.
Yeah. So what interference are you? Can you please elaborate?
So let's say if you take the 1D crystal itself. Okay. In the 1D crystal also, we had only certain values of the k, right? Okay, now imagine that even before the 1D crystal, let's take a system where we had only, let's say, two coupled oscillators. Okay, so this is also attached to this, let's say. So in such a case, if you had only two coupled oscillators, or let's take another situation where this is... So in such a case, when you have two coupled oscillators, you know that you will have only two normal modes, right?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
So what do these two normal modes respond to? Question. Then it turns out that there are only certain values of the frequency where every atom in the system, every oscillator in the system has exactly the same frequency and the same... that's correct. It has the same frequency, because remember, when we solved the system, we took we took this as the approximation. Let's say un was some un tilde e to the power I omega t, which means all the atoms in the system have exactly the same frequency. Essentially, what you're saying is there are only certain possible ways of vibrating where every atom in the system has exactly the same frequency. Okay, and that if you visualize them, then you will see that they correspond to certain interference conditions. Okay, so I have included some pictures in the notes. You can see them in the drive, and you will see that there is a kind of an interference that is happening. Okay, and that is what is leading to a survival of certain modes, and the other modes will not be allowed. Happens even in electrons, when electrons, so in the Bohr's model, for example, there is a quantization of angular momentum and so on. Okay, so all that arises from there. that only certain wavelengths can survive, and because only certain wavelengths can survive and so on, so you can get a quantization of the angular momentum. So it's a very similar picture. In a crystal, it's harder to visualize, but essentially the same thing is happening, that only certain modes are allowed, which will allow the entire system of crystal atoms to vibrate with the same frequency.
Subject to periodic boundary condition.
Subject to periodic boundary. So in fact, there was a question by Sapriti about these amorphous systems also. Okay. Out that amorphous systems do not have periodicity, definitely. Amorphous systems not have phonons. So the answer is no, the amorphous systems can also have phonons. Okay. I mean, I answered the question wrongly, I guess. Yeah, the amorphous systems do have phonons, but these phonons are not described by the K index. And these phonons are basically normal modes of the amorphous system itself. That let me take an example of a 1D crystal. Okay, in this 1D crystal, I will approximate the amorphousness in the following way. The spring constant is K1, K2, K3, K4, and so on. So the springs are not all equal. In fact, the spring constants might be actually taken by distribution. I could have done that, right? And this is a kind of an approximation of a 1D amorphous crystal. Now you can ask the question, will this amorphous system have normal modes? Okay, and indeed they could. So you can write again the equation for each one of them. You will get an n by n matrix, okay, where this is u1, u2, and so on. So for a homogeneous or a periodic 1D crystal, we saw that all the diagonal elements were the same, all the off-diagonal elements were the same, and this element was non-zero here. In the amorphous case, you will find that here these values are not all the same, because the masses could be different, the spring constants could be different, and so on. Still be a real symmetric matrix. And when you solve this system, you will again get n eigenvalues. And these n eigenvalues will correspond to n normal modes. Normal modes are, again, remember, these are modes of vibration of the crystal. So modes of vibration of the crystal can have certain patterns. So there would be certain pattern in which these crystals would vibrate. Okay, and that you can find out by looking at what are the displacements like. You can solve such problems, and then one can find out what is the value of u2 all the way up to un in terms of u1, and then visualize them in real time. Okay, so there are many simulations that you can see on the web where you can look at what does each mode look like. Okay, and you can also write simple programs and visualize them using software called JMOL or many other softwares. Okay. So amorphous systems also have phonons, but they are not phonons in the usual sense of a periodic crystal. They are normal modes. Okay. Any other question?
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Okay. So if this is okay, then let me move on now to the quantum mechanical solution of a 1D simple harmonic, of a 1D coupled harmonic oscillator. So it will go back to the 1D coupled harmonic oscillator. Okay. And what we have done now is we have done the classical solution. Okay. And by looking at the classical solution, we have arrived at the normal modes. And these normal modes are characterized by a certain dispersion. So this omega k is given by omega k squared is given by 4k by m sine squared ka by 2. Okay. Now what is very interesting is that when we look at the quantum mechanical solution, these normal modes are exactly the same. Okay, so the as far as the normal modes are concerned, you will not find any difference between the classical solution and the quantum mechanical solution. But the way you go ahead from here, right, the partition function, for example, for this, and the partition function for this, the thermodynamics will be completely different. Okay, they will not be the same, right? So let's look at how the quantum mechanical solution proceeds. So for the quantum mechanical solution, what I have also done is the solution is quite detailed, and I have put the notes in the directory. I will just point out the notes. See, where is it? Yeah, no, not here. Yeah, so if you look at these notes called Quantum Model of a Crystal, this is from MIT courseware, and in the section 9.2.4, there is a full detailed solution. Or maybe not, maybe further ahead. Yeah, that's right. So you again start with this kind of a model. Okay, you again start with xn minus xn plus 1 whole squared and pn squared by 2m, and each of these xn's is now written as a Fourier series. Okay, so when you write this as a Fourier series, remember the xk's here, and these xk's are now quantized, and these xk's are written in terms of the creation annihilation operators. Okay. So remember, this is what is done even for the simple harmonic oscillator, which is a single quantum harmonic oscillator in quantum mechanics, right? So now what one has to do is one has to write the xn and the pn, okay, in terms of these creation annihilation operators. And once you write this xn and pn in terms of this, then you take these and then substitute back into the Hamiltonian. Okay, once you substitute these back into the Hamiltonian, then you can show that the Hamiltonian diagonalizes, and what you get finally is this. You will get Hamiltonian as sum over k omega k ak dagger ak plus half, okay, which looks exactly similar to that of the quantum harmonic oscillator that we did in quantum mechanics. The only difference here is that you have n different harmonic oscillators. Okay, and each having a different frequency omega k, where the omega k is exactly the same that we found in the classical case, right? So the normal mode, the dispersion in the classical case and the quantum case is exactly the same. Okay, and in the quantum case, what we can see very clearly is that the entire system, which is a coupled harmonic oscillator system, breaks up into n different uncoupled harmonic oscillators. But the uncoupling of this entire system does not happen in real space. It happens in k space. Okay, so this is a very significant thing. In fact, we might see several examples of this later also, that a system which is strongly coupled in real space gets completely uncoupled space. Okay, there are many such examples. For example, if you look at the tight binding model of electrons in a crystal, then the electrons are hopping from one side to the other side, and in real space it looks like a very complicated system, because once the electron has to hop, it has to make sure that the Pauli's exclusion principle is not violated, okay, and the same spin electron is not present on the other side, and so on. So it's a highly correlated problem in real space, but once you Fourier transform it to k space, you will see that the entire system gets decoupled. Okay, each there are epsilon, you get the energy as a function of momentum, and each k behaves completely independently. Okay, so the same thing is happening here. You get n different harmonic oscillators which are behaving completely independently, And this is the reason why solving the quantum mechanical problem from here onwards becomes very simple. Because when you have to find the partition function, you can see that taking the trace becomes extremely easy. It's like n different harmonic oscillators. So if you have solved one harmonic oscillator problem, you have solved the entire system. Okay, so that is a simplification that happens. Now, let us see how to calculate these quantities. But essentially, you can take a look at these notes and follow the algebra. So because it's quantum mechanics and there are a lot of commutation relations that one has to use, I have not gone into it. And this is obviously not within the scope of this course, but it's very simple to follow. Okay, so those of you who are interested in the solution, please go through this. And if once you arrive at this, then you will see that the correspondence between the classical case and the quantum case is very strong as regards to the dispersion. Okay, so the dispersion is exactly the same in the classical case and the quantum case. Okay, so the quantum mechanical case also, the normal modes turn out to be exactly the same. Okay, so is this point clear to everyone? I mean, I have not shown you the derivation, but do you understand the statement that the normal modes are exactly the same in the classical case and the quantum mechanical case? Okay, and all that we are doing is we are doing again a Fourier transform of the real space system and decoupling all the coupled harmonic oscillators. The harmonic oscillators which were strongly coupled to each other in the real space get decoupled in the k-space. Okay, is this statement clear to everyone? Okay, so I assume silence is yes.
Hello.
Yeah.
Sir.
Yes.
Sir, in quantum mechanical system, if the energy is correlation is decoupled, then how the all the system will vibrate to one frequency? Because the vibration of the total system, and total system should vibrate in a single frequency. So if it is decoupled, so how a single frequency vibration can be achieved?
So, okay, you are making many statements, but let me talk about one statement. So, you understood that in the classical case, we took the ansatz that un is theta, which is independent of time, times e to the power I omega t. You agreed with this, right?
Yes, sir.
Do you agree with this? Yeah, good. Now, here, yes, let me take the same quantum mechanical Hamiltonian, omega k, ak dagger ak plus half. Okay, is that fine? This is the quantum mechanical Hamiltonian, yeah. Right? Okay, now what you can do is you can write down the Heisenberg's equation of motion for the xn operator. Okay? Okay, so here what you will see is that the Heisenberg's equation of motion for the xn operator, if you write that, remember xn was a sum over k of something times ak and something times ak dagger, right? That was xn, right? Heisenberg's equation of motion, you have to basically find the commutator of the xn with the Hamiltonian. Okay, so if you find that, you will see that ak and ak dagger, in fact, the ak and ak dagger have a commutation relation which is bosonic, and you will get delta kk prime. Okay, so what you will see is that ak of t is actually e to the power I omega k t times ak, and similarly ak dagger of t will be e to the power minus I omega k t times ak dagger. Okay, so what you see is that all the AKs, okay, they are vibrating with exactly the same frequencies. These are creation annihilation operators. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, so essentially what you can show is that the system becomes completely decoupled in K space, by which we mean that when you if you want to excite only a certain mode in the system, okay, then you can give in multiples of that particular omega k, and that would give rise to only those specific modes. Okay. So okay. See, the thing is, you should not use the same visualization that you used in the classical case, in the sense of the atoms vibrating and you are looking at their position and momentum. Remember, these are all quantum mechanical oscillators. Okay. And if you look at a single quantum mechanical oscillator, even that visualization is not easy. If you remember, I had asked the question, what is the amplitude of vibration of a single quantum mechanical harmonic oscillator? Can you tell me the answer? If I'll just remind you, for a quantum mechanical harmonic oscillator, the Hamiltonian is again given by omega naught times e dagger a plus half. You agree with this?
Yeah.
What is the ground state of this Hamiltonian? It's a Gaussian function. Okay, e to the power.
Yeah,
right. So e to the power minus alpha x squared. Correct. Okay. But what is the potential energy of this system? The potential energy is something like this.
Half k
x squared. Correct. So now tell me that what is the amplitude of vibration of this particular quantum mechanical oscillator? So just to motivate you, if I had a classical oscillator and I give it a certain energy, okay, then I know that the classical oscillator cannot go beyond these boundaries. This will in fact become the amplitude of the oscillation of the classical oscillator. Okay. But for the quantum mechanical oscillator, you just now said that the wave function is e to the power minus alpha x squared. Okay, so the probability of finding the particle even far from this place where the potential energy could be huge. Okay, the potential energy is somewhere here, right? But there is a finite probability of finding the particle even here. So, you know, it's not like these atoms are vibrating with fixed amplitudes and so on. These are quantum mechanical oscillators and there are certain wave functions. So you can only define for example, an expectation value of the x squared, and square root of that will be the amplitude.
Yeah.
Okay. But this is not a fixed amplitude.
It may vary.
Isn't it? So this is not a fixed amplitude, and a classical visualization of this quantum harmonic oscillator chain should not be done. Okay.
Okay, sir.
However, when you look at the quantum mechanical time evolution of this harmonic oscillator chain, then you will see that each harmonic oscillator is evolving independently with this frequency omega k. That is the essence in which we are saying that each of these is oscillating with the same frequency omega k.
Okay, sir. So in classical, they will be dependent and they will something in classically they will oscillate. But in if we look in the time domain, the picture of the wave function, that each system, each point will oscillate with omega k. And there
not each point. No. Wait. It's not each point in real space. It's each mode in
k space.
Yeah. That's right.
Yeah. In case space, with each frequency omega k, and omega k is for different k.
Exactly.
Okay.
So there are these differences that crop up when you go deeper into the quantum mechanical solution versus classical solution. And the classical solution has a proper x momentum phase space where you can visualize the elliptic curves of the phase trajectories. In the quantum mechanical case, you cannot visualize that. Okay. So what you have to do is you have to go back to the partition function, right? And then write down so that is what we will do next. Once we write down the partition function, we can find out things like specific heat. And then if you add in other properties, then you can find out other properties also, okay? So is that clear that the quantum mechanical solution and the classical solution, they match with each other up to the level of normal modes. But once you start looking deeper into the time evolution and so on, then they become extremely different. You have to incorporate the classical laws, the commutation relations in the quantum mechanical case and so on. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Any other question? No? Okay. So let me, yeah, any question? No? Okay. So now what I have not shown you here is that if you look at Pn squared by 2m plus half k times xn minus xn plus 1 whole squared, this is the Hamiltonian. And if you do this classically, okay, using classical mechanics, this again breaks up into pk, p minus k, and then xk, x minus k. Okay, so this kind of a solution. And what you can do is you can do the partition function for this, use the equipartition theorem. Okay, and using the equipartition theorem, you will find that again you get the 3 by 2 nkb. Okay, and it's twice that. So, because there is kinetic energy plus potential energy. So, in fact, you will find that the specific heat of, so this is the specific heat coefficient. So the specific heat coefficient again becomes a constant. Okay, so the specific heat is actually a, sorry, this is not specific heat coefficient, this specific heat itself. So the specific heat of this classical system is a constant and is independent of temperature. Okay, so the classical harmonic oscillator system, even if you take a single oscillator versus a system of coupled harmonic oscillators, you get exactly the same qualitative answer, that the specific heat is independent of the temperature. Okay, so but we know that that is not true, right? That in general the specific heat has a form which looks like AT plus BT cube. Okay, and this we know is the electronic contribution, and this is the phonon contribution. Okay, so, and all of you know this, so that is why I'm hurrying up a little bit, that this phonon contribution comes because of quantum nature of phonons. Okay, and for incorporating the quantum nature of phonons, we have to incorporate the Bose-Einstein distribution. Okay, so that is where the quantum mechanical nature of the phonons comes in. So Bose-Einstein distribution. And even this Bose-Einstein distribution can actually be derived using the quantum mechanical partition function. Okay? So if you find out the average value of nk of the phonons, you will actually get the Bose-Einstein distribution. Right? So this also many of you would have done in the quantum statmic course, quantum statistical mechanics course, right? So we will be looking at the specific heat and also at the derivation of the Bose-Einstein distribution. Okay, but basically our aim is to look at the specific heat, right? So this is something that we will do in the next class for two reasons. One, it is 3:28, and the other is the battery on my laptop is showing 6%, and I didn't bring the charger. Okay, so unfortunately I will not be able to take questions today, but please do write to me. Okay, many of you have been writing to me also, and also if you have questions and you don't want to write, then just wait until the next class and we will discuss them. Okay, so I will have to close this now. And okay, so okay, so then see you tomorrow.
Thank you, sir.